As part of Youth Month, the Morris Isaacson Center for Music in Soweto earlier today held the 60th Imashinini Memorial Lecture. The lecture featured two main speakers, Professor Koleka Mlisana, the co-chair of the Ministerial Advisory Committee on COVID-19, and Professor Bonang Mohale, University of Free State's Chancellor. Now we speak to Veli Mbele, an Afrocentric essayist, to discuss Youth Month as well as what was discussed at the memorial lecture. Mr. Mbele, thank you so much for your time and for joining me this afternoon at such short notice. We do appreciate it.
Thank you so much, Dadwethu Unathi, for the opportunity.
Now, in his lecture, Professor Mohale was unscathing. He said, he was scathing, saying that South Africa is at a point in time that it looks like we're still in 1976, essentially saying that in the 21st century, 27 years after democracy, that South Africa was still one of the most unequal societies, and the youth being at the forefront of being affected because of that.
Yes, I mean, the reason why Professor Mohale came to that conclusion has to do with an unresolved issue, you know, that for over 20 years we have not been confronting. And that has to do with the issue which is called the national question. Now, the national question concerns itself with two fundamental issues, which is whether South Africa has extricated itself from the yoke of colonialism, and two, as part of that extrication, whether the issue of the repossession of the land has been addressed, because you can't expect a native majority, right, to eke out a living when they don't control the means with which to eke out a living, and land is central to that. So the reason why you have this constant observations about us being the most unequal society and all other forms of observation have to do with the fact that we have not addressed the national and the land question. So for as long as those two questions have not been resolved, we will continue to have these types of observations where the issue of inequality and black inequality, to be exact, continues to be a feature of South African society.
Now, during the lecture, a very young student, stood up and spoke about just how unequal the society is. And I mean, it is 2021. She's a young student, probably the same age as Tsietsi Mashinini was when he took it upon himself with a few other students to, you know, march against oppressors of the time. And she said that the society of today is still unequal. And what she was referring to was just the access in terms of vaccines that we are seeing displaying themselves out now in South Africa. I mean, South Africa is lagging behind even countries in this continent in terms of, you know, just fast-tracking the accessibility of vaccines to probably some of the most disadvantaged people, people that need those vaccines. What does that tell us about the state of our country?
Yes, and look, the other sad thing is that a number of people, and first to say the young person you're referring to makes a valid observation. But the sad thing is, and it perhaps has to do with, maybe we have a problem of national amnesia in this country. There are people in this country who create the impression that we only became aware of the levels of inequality, and especially black inequality, with the advent of COVID, right? So we have had this inequality for over two decades, and we've always known it is there. There are many studies that have been done that speak to that. What we have lacked, right, has been the courage to deal with that inequality decisively. And the courage has to do with the fact that unless we address the fundamentally racially skewed nature of the South African economy, we are not going to be dealing with inequality, because embedded in the structure of the South African economy is racial inequality, because the South African economy is racialized. So inequality will also have the same dimension. So the observation that your student made or the young person made is absolutely correct. So until we develop the courage to deal with the racially skewed nature of the South African economy and deal with it decisively, we will continue to have conference after conference, meeting after meeting, bemoaning the levels of inequality and in particular black inequality.
And one of the key reasons for some of the things that you are mentioning now is that people are saying there is that deficiency in leadership, that we are not seeing leaders in this country that should be, you know, leading in a manner in which certain things that happened in the past should be addressed so that we can have some form of redress, especially in what you speak of in terms of a land redistribution and also the inequality that is so pervasive in the country at the moment. What do we make of the leaders in this country, particularly as South Africa, we are going into those local municipal elections in October? The youth are also finding themselves at a very sensitive stage in that there is this high unemployment that especially affects them.
Yes, I don't want the young people of our country to waste their time, right? You know, talking endlessly about the quality or lack thereof of the leadership in this country. In the context of the day on in which we are having this discussion, which is the student uprising of 1976, it is important that our young people understand, and in particular black young people who bear the biggest brunt of inequality, that the solutions to their problems will come from them and from nobody else. And my own view is that it is important for the young people of our country to stop outsourcing the responsibility to change their circumstances. Tsietsi Mashinini, Khotso Seahlolo and others demonstrated there is historical precedent that the young people of our country are more than capable of changing their reality. And for me, that is the thing, that continuing to lament, you know, or bemoan the quality of leadership amongst the older generation or lack thereof is not necessarily going to resolve or solve the fundamental problems of young people. We must get young people organizing themselves and taking initiative to develop solutions to the types of challenges they are facing. That for me is the most realistic attitude to assume.
And what are some of those practical steps that they could take? I mean, we do know that, you know, in order for you to move forward, you have to, you have to know that you are going to put yourself in a very uncomfortable position. I mean, you reference the 1976 uprising, where those youth took it upon themselves, you know, to start something, knowing very well that it was probably not going to end very well. So what are some of the practical examples that the youth of today who know that there is this deficiency in the leadership, in the current leadership, or who have said that, they've articulated that, what can they do practically, also taking into consideration the economic situation in our country?
Yes. And you must also understand, right, Tsietsi Mashinini, Khotso Seahlolo and others, right, probably faced a more vicious and more merciless government at the time. But in spite of that, right, they developed the courage of their convictions to rise to the challenge of their time. And this is why we continue to talk about them today. So the point that one is making is that in the context of where the young people of South Africa find themselves today, they have a responsibility to organize themselves in their various communities. And on the basis of the types of problems they are experiencing, many of them being economic, that they use these organizations that they would start at grassroots levels, right? For those organizations to fight for them to get the types of things that they want in the areas of the economy, whether it's in the areas of education. So as things stand now, the big challenge that I think our young people are facing, right? First, I don't think many of them have the necessary confidence that they can do those things. I believe they can. Secondly, I don't think they are purposefully organized to understand that they can give national leadership and national direction to the country. Can our young people stop outsourcing the responsibility to define their destiny and to define the destiny of this country. They are more than capable of doing that, and they should just organize themselves accordingly, and we would see that they would be able to do these things.
Very quickly, Veli, just as we wrap up this discussion, it is Youth Month. We are going to be commemorating the 16th of June. What is your message to the youth of South Africa as things stand now? I mean, we've just raised a number of issues you know, the economic factor also being one of them, as well as obviously the inequality, high unemployment, COVID-19, which has left many devastated because of the pandemic and the consequences of the lockdown.
Okay, first and foremost, it is important for our young people to understand, right, that they don't have to give in to their problems, you know, and develop a paralysis. Whatever challenges that they are confronted with, many of them being very serious challenges, should not plunge them into a state of paralysis. That's the first thing. Secondly, the types of challenges or problems they are facing also give them an opportunity to write their names into history. And as a generation, also contribute, right, to the project that Tsietsi Mashinini and others have started. So that's the second thing. And then the third thing, it is also important for them to give themselves time to study and understand what days like or moments like June 16 were really about, so that they are able to get the necessary inspiration, because you can't effect fundamental change if you don't have a proper sense of history. So I want to urge them to rise to the occasion and for them to fulfill their generational mission.
All right, Veli, thank you so much for your time. Really do appreciate it this afternoon. That was Veli Mbele, an Afrocentric essayist, just discussing about the legacy of Tsietsi Mashinini.